the maiden voyage with Doc.
Are some secondary schools, is there?
Yeah.
Do they, some of the secondary schools, do they live at school?
No.
Hey, you. Et tu viens pour la tu sors quand tu charges.
Tu viens, tu vas voir tu la marques.
Hey,
les sept là.
Ouais.
Et d'un coup les miens m'aiment.
You told me to go right!
You have to turn around!
Where?
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 Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where?
Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where?
Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? Where? I've been sabotaged immediately.
No, boy.
There's no way I have enough room. Oh my god. Oh, he's waiting for me.
Oh, Alec, nice. He has a choice. You're in the middle of the road.
Well, hello everybody and welcome in to Monday Night Live Uganda Team Edition. We are so excited and thrilled to have you here with us. If you're here tonight, say hello in the chat. I want to say hello to a lot of really awesome people. We got Faye and Doc and Tex Holden, Beggy Man, my wife, Christian Ninja, Fox, Capsian. We got Squawk here and Breach. Bougie, it's good to see you tonight. All of the other folks were here. Katie, who's here, who just had a new baby. Y'all, Katie had a baby, and she's here tonight, which is unbelievable. So welcome in. Zeph, it's good to see you as well. Druzy, hello and welcome in tonight. I got behind me none other than the G-Mill and my brother, Barbotus Kyle, who's here with us tonight. And then I also have Doc, who's coming in over a call tonight. We have the entire Uganda team. And just for the record, that only was the plan for the last couple of hours. I was literally planning on doing Monday Night Live with 100 some photos by myself, but let me tell you, tonight we have about 8 video clips out of the gigs and gigs of data that Greg took while we were there on the trip. We have 360 plus photos that we're going to be going through of the trip. You're going to hear commentary from all four of us who are on the trip. You're going to be able to ask questions about what happened on the trip, and we're going to be telling you about what's coming next, including opportunity for you to partner with Maisha School to support orphans and children who don't have a place to live or a place to go and who are currently living at Maisha School, and how to help us continue to build the school in Kagata, Uganda. And so we're going to be talking about all of that tonight. We're opening up our giving platform tonight, and every cent that comes into Lux tonight, all is going to go directly to Maisha Schools in Kagata. And we're going to be talking about also future partnerships and future trips that you might be able to take part in. So we're so glad to have you here with us tonight. This is like our last Monday Night Live was literally me sitting back and answering theological questions, which was amazing and super fun. But this one is going to be so different than what we did last month. And I think each one of our Monday Night Lives are going to kind of be unique in that way. So I'm sitting here at the PC controlling stuff, but I'm going to welcome in my missions team for the 2023 Uganda trip. Gonna go ahead and unmute these guys who are on the couch. Oh my gosh, you can double hear me and it's the worst. I don't know how that's gonna
just
work.
Let it run.
Double mark. Okay. Well, let me welcome in Kyle, Greg, and Doc. Welcome in, guys.
Hello, hello.
Hi, everybody.
Hello, hello.
Welcome, welcome. Gamer Medic, hello, welcome in. Susie, hello, and welcome in. Brenda Lutz, welcome in. Ben, thanks for stopping by. Sheebs is alive, and he is here as well. Sheebs. We're so glad to have you guys. Guys, this is the first time we've all been in like the same call since Doc got separated from us and had to sprint on his way to his next flight while in D.C.
I just want to say my last interaction with Doc before he disappeared was, hey, I'm going to go down here and look for the bags. So I was like, okay, I'll go down here and look for the bags. And then we're both looking, and I see him like pop up with his bag, but I was at the other end of the terminal. So I'm walking around. By the time I get there, Doc is gone. So I never actually got to say goodbye.
Yeah. Bye, Greg.
Bye, Doc.
Bye, Greg.
Mark was way behind.
Real behind.
He definitely didn't get to say goodbye.
I literally kept track of my passport perfectly well the entire trip until we got off the plane into DC and I left it on the plane and then they would not allow me back on the plane. So I ended up being like literally the last person like off the plane in a way, which was the worst, by the way.
Very long customs line. Very long.
Yeah. Really long customs line in DC.
I was very thankful for there's a lady waiting by past customs that was from American Airlines that was like asking people if we're on American Airlines, and I said yes. And she took my bag, gave me my boarding passes, and checked my bag for me so I could run to the gate and get through security again. So if it wasn't for her, I might have been messaging them and carpooling back to Philly.
What is our stream title? A Real Church on Twitch. Literally not the correct stream title. Hold up. Let me go change that real quick.
I mean, it's accurate, but
tonight
not...
we're a fake church.
Yeah.
Tonight we're a fake one.
AMC April? Is that AMC April?
Hello. Hi, AMC April. How are you tonight?
Nice to have you.
AMC April, my name is Mark. I'm the pastor of Lux. This is Doc with the... long but medium beard somehow.
I'm medium.
In the top right hand corner, he's one of our elders. The long red beard is my brother Kyle, and Greg is also here. He's our video director, sitting on the couch with Kyle.
The no short red beard.
Yes.
I do really like that. My bald spot is nice and visible because of Mark's stream. My head's just back there.
It from behind me. Like if you want to look at Kyle's bald spot, it's right. Oh, sorry.
Thank you for just smacking me upside the head. Just, I appreciate that.
I didn't know. I couldn't tell how far I was. I couldn't tell how far away I was.
Not necessary. So
let me give a quick rundown on the trip, and I forget something, you guys can correct me, and then we'll share a bunch of photos. So basically, on Wednesday, July 6th, we got together, packed a bunch of bags, drove to D.C., and then flew from D.C. to Brussels, and then flew from Brussels to Rwanda, then Rwanda to Uganda, and then spent the night there. And so just to give you guys an idea, most international mission trips, you would go with a American team. And so like there'd be an American-based organization. They'd have sort of boots on the ground. You would go and hang out with them. Zemo Wonky? I probably absolutely butchered that. So I'm finally able to catch a stream. I've been eating up the VOD lately. Well, hey, welcome in. You're here for Monday Night Live. So we're talking about this group of people right here went to Uganda for 2 weeks together, and we just got back last Wednesday. So most mission teams, you'll literally spend like all of your time with a mission partner. But for us, there was no mission partner. There's no American-based missions organization. It's like as on the ground as you're gonna get. So like we literally landed in Uganda and got picked up by two people who have lived in Uganda their entire life. Robert and Millie. I always pronounce it Kikamiko, but what is it, guys? Did you?
Don't put me on the spot. I have it in one of the videos, but it's not Kikamiko. It's pronounced with like a C almost at the beginning of it.
Chikamiki. No.
Nope. No, that's worse.
No.
Definitely not that.
I really hope they don't just by happenstance watch this exact video.
So like we were really immersed in Ugandan culture the entire time that we were there, living with Robert and Millie. So Robert and Millie
Chikomiko?
Chikomiko. Yeah. Robert and Millie started a school in a little town called Kagati in Uganda. It's the poorest district of Uganda. And they now have 450 students at the school, which started with only a handful. Cut the music, Jenny says. You got it. 450 students. 450 students there. 120 or so of those students are orphaned. 74 of them now live, as of Sunday, 74 live at the school. We'll talk about that. Live at the school, and the rest of them live in sort of like their own homemade foster care system that's run by the school. And then in addition to that, 5 hours away where their home is, they have another 14 15 orphans who live inside of their home that ranges in age from Tara, who we'll probably see a picture of, who's just, I think, like three, up through the oldest, which I think is Thomas. I think he's like 22.
I thought 26. They said Tara was 26. Six.
Tara? No, I think Tara's three or four.
Tara was three. There was two. There was a four-year-old and then two six-year-olds. So they have four little ones. And then I think there was there's 13 teenagers if you include Thomas, who's 26. I kind of considered him a teenager, but yeah, there's 13 teenagers and above they take care of, and then they have their own two kids and four of them that are six and under they also take care of that are not theirs.
Somewhere along the line, I thought I heard somebody say that Tara was six, and it wildly confused me because I was like, she looks very young to be six.
Yeah, she's three, yeah.
Okay, that makes a lot more sense. I don't know.
Davis was seven. I'm hoping we have a picture of him.
Heard that in the sleepy days.
I literally am messaging Stormbrave Tale on Discord right now, and he's like, I'm watching you type to me. Okay, thanks for coming to stream tonight, Stormbrave. Dusty Disciple, good to see you. Welcome in. So here's what we're going to do. We're gonna go here. Wow, that was like a really cool transition because we all zigzagged.
Can you do it again?
Look at that. I did not do that intentionally, but we all sort of like swiped away. Look at that. It's so cool. Really. Guys, I do this for a living. and so we're going to have a little fun romp through
five more times.
through a whole bunch of pictures. So we'll share them with you. So this is the first picture. This is a picture of us, our team.
Mark loves khakis.
Right before we left. Yeah. Just so for the record. The fact that there's now a picture of me on the internet in khakis is my least favorite part of this trip.
At least I didn't put the really bad one on there.
Oh my gosh, it's so bad. It's so bad. Five in chat if you hate khakis. And you should. is this the next picture, Greg? Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. You want?
I didn't take any pictures on my camera the entire way until we were at the home the next morning.
So literally we have this one. Hello, we're leaving, and then
hey, we're there.
No part of the drive, the flights.
48 hours later. 48 hours later, we're now in Uganda.
Don't show that, Greg. 48 hours. Yeah, 48 hours later, we're literally here. We are in Uganda, and so this picture is of. Some of the children at Robert and Millie's home in Kampala, which is the capital city. So you can kind of see the two sort of older kids that are sitting there are AMZ April. Join us on Discord. We'd love to have you there. The two older kids are two orphans that live there at the school or live there at their home. And then I believe sort of like the girl in the checkered dress there, they're two boys sitting next to her. I think... Well, the one is definitely one of their sons, correct? Travis?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And then I think Tyler is one of the kids there as well. But that's Gabriella, Tara, Seth, and Liam, I think. Maybe Tyler isn't there. But those are a whole bunch of some of the examples of the children who actually live with Robert and Millie inside their home. Hmm. Greg, what is this? Because you took this.
He took the piece of paper from one of our notebooks and he wrote a letter. I think it's in English. I think his handwriting is just still, you know, he's still practicing his letters. So I'm sure that you could actually read it, but just at the bottom it says, like, we had literally just met him and he wrote, like, love you with my heart.
I'm pretty confident I have that letter.
Yeah.
I'm pretty confident I brought that home with me.
Yeah, and this is Liam.
Yep.
Right.
Liam's. Yeah. I think he's the six-year-old orphan that lives with them.
Yeah. This is Liam, and this is Seth.
Yep.
Yeah. So Seth came. So one of the things that we did was we heard a lot of stories of some of the kids. So just to give you a quick idea. Thank you. I have to go. I wanted to join because I've been trying to find more Christians because I had a fallout with a couple of them. And thank you and God bless. Well, hey, AMC, glad to have you here. Stop by anytime. We have service every Wednesday night at 8:30 p.m. How you understand what they say, what they're saying, or do they speak English? Dusty asked.
Doc?
Yeah, Doc, you want to explain?
I mean, most of the kids, once they're a little bit older, are going to speak English. Uganda has a few languages, like they have Swahili and other languages as well. When we get up into Kigali, they speak I'm going to pronounce it poorly, but Unyoro.
Yeah, Unyoro.
Which is a, like, Unyoro, mm-hmm. Which is, like, a local dialect. Like, it, I was trying to look it up today to try to figure out ways to do dictionaries. You can't hardly even find it on the internet of, like, how to actually translate it, because it's so specific to just that one region of Uganda. But once the kids get kind of in their kind of first grades of school, they start learning English right away. So, like, the kids are, the younger kids are actually really good at translating for you. So,
yeah. And so one of the things we did was we started hearing, like, as soon as we got there, I basically started asking for stories of the children who live there at their home and, like, why they live there. Because keep in mind, Robert and Millie have, they don't have a lot of money. They have basically a 3-bedroom home with 1 bathroom, and they have, there's 19 people who live inside their home, 19 people inside their little home. And so I wanted to know what were some of the stories. So Seth, for example, had come to their home because he had been pretty viciously abused. So his elbow, his bones were broken at about his elbow, I think by his father when he was a little bit younger, and it never healed properly. So his arm actually bends way beyond where it should and still causes him some pain. But after he had kind of been thrown, I think he was thrown against a wall and his arm was broken by his father, they ended up pulling him out of the house. And ended up, as a product of that, ended up with Robert and Millie. And that's where, you know, he'll live for the rest of his, well, for his childhood at least. He'll live there with Robert and Millie. Just came back. Now we got kids chucking gang signs. Yeah, this gamer medic, this is Seth. He was one of the abused children who ended up in Robert and Millie's care inside their homes. These are 4 of the young ladies who, amongst a whole bunch that live at the house. We'll see a whole bunch of pictures of them. I don't know if I remember all of their names.
Teddy's far left. Bridget is in the tie-dye. I forget the...
Christine is in the red, isn't she?
Yes. That's what I thought, yeah.
Christine's in the red. Yep. Let's apologize. We had to try to understand... not only the 20-some people nearly in their home, their names, but also when we got to Kigali, there are 70 orphans there, 74, that all are trying to tell you their name. So for the most part, there are not many names we were able to keep, except at Robert and Millie's, we spent an entire day there on the way home. So it gave us a lot more time to know their names.
Yeah, and Catherine was the girl who was in the blue dress.
That's Edward, right? Edward was the boy in that last picture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's Edward.
So when Edward came to Robert and Millie's house, he had been an orphan since, like, he was very, very young. And Millie said that he kept working and working and working and working and doing all the chores around the house. And they couldn't kind of figure out why. And here he thought that basically it was sort of like eventually kids would start getting kicked out of the house. They were just there temporarily. And he was thinking that if he made himself as useful as he could, that maybe he would be able to keep a place to live, and has now really kind of become part of the family. And it was really powerful. On one of the last nights, the kids had written letters to Robert and Millie, who are basically have become their parents, and they review them. They view them as mom and dad. It was really powerful to hear him read, Edward read some of the letter that he had written to Robert and Millie, which was really cool. As a kid who, you know, has grown up his entire life, his family's all dead. Most of these kids, so for the record, most of these older kids, these were all kids that went to Maisha's school, which you'll see pictures of in a bit. And all of them ended up sort of graduating from the school and had no place to go because none of them had families or they weren't safe inside their homes. And Robert and Millie didn't want to just put them on the streets. So they literally just opened their home and began taking in the older kids who now all live at their home in Kampala, which is unfreaking believable, by the way.
Yeah.
So for the record, like, they are responsible for the food, shelter, clothing of and secondary education for all 11 young adults who live there from like 17 to 24, I think. And then also for the 4 children that are young that they took into their home as well. And these are all just pictures of us with them. We left sort of like the second day of our trip. Our first day of our trip, we sort of landed, came here, slept. The next morning, we woke up and drove from there to Kigali. So this was just some group pictures with them. We did come back and spend some time with them when we came back. But this was just some – that's a great picture, Kyle.
Something that was kind of neat when we were there is just when you're in their bedrooms, you know, like we just – in my own home, built a bedroom downstairs for my son. So he had his own room and – you know, and that was important for us. But when we go into their home, they cleared out one of the bedrooms so that we could live in it for the time that we were there. And it is literally two triple stack bunk beds because they fit six or so kids in each room. And then the boys, since they can't, you know, they don't stay in the same room with the girls, live out back in actually that building we're looking at right now. Yeah. That gray building is where the boys live.
Yeah, there's like, oh, there's two boys in there. And there's another building out back, too, that I think some of the girls live in. Or do all the girls live in the house?
I think they all live in the house. That back room I saw back there, I think, was all their laundry and food that they were doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the two boys, Thomas and Edward, live in that gray building that you see right there.
And that big black water tank is a source of their water. So all through the country, you would see those. And when it rains, the gutters all run into those. And then the hot African sun helps warm up that water. And that's their hot water for a lot of what they use during the day.
And their house has this wall around it that you can see, this gray wall with an electrified wire that runs around the top of it to keep thieves from coming in. And it's held together with a big gate.
Yeah, there's a big gate. That was a map the one kid drew.
Yeah, that's Liam was drawing stuff for us. He was really interested in drawing, so he drew a bunch of stuff for us.
I think he ended up with one of our hats. Is that one of the hats you gave him, Greg?
Yeah, I gave him the hat when we first got there.
Yeah. So this was us sort of, you can see the front gate to their house here, and you can see us taking and strapping down all the supplies. So you guys wondering, over 2 months, we asked our church to send supplies to take with us to Uganda, and we ended up taking 400 pounds of soap, toothbrushes, toothpaste, balloons, candy, medical supplies. 400 pounds that we had to bring with us, which was amazing, toys, all kinds of stuff. And those are the suitcases on top of the van. So we had about a 5-hour drive this day from Kampala on the dirt roads to get to Kigali. And we strapped all of the stuff that you guys donated to the top of the vans here to take with us to the school.
It was pretty incredible. I mean, like, we were hucking through the airport with, like,
a lot of
suitcases
luggage.
And suitcases of stuff that...
I'm going to say a quick hello because I went to when the stream started to my wife and children who are watching, and also to mom and dad. I saw you guys in chat briefly, so thank you guys for watching.
Hi, guys. So this was a group picture before we left. So you can see right in the middle of the picture is Robert and Millie, who, like, they've started this whole thing. So Robert is in the red jersey there, and his wife Millie is in the tan shirt and white pants right next to him. And then if you look on the far right-hand side, you'll see two of Robert's disciples, the two young men. The one in the front was sort of like the – I don't even know what that shirt is.
Is it like camouflage? Kind of like – what is that? I think it's
fish,
like,
on it or something.
I think it's like camouflage. I don't know.
That's Raymond, and the guy behind him is Tony.
And their wives are right next to them.
Yeah, Doc, were you talking in chat about being Jewish or Muslim because of your beard?
Yeah, we got that a few times.
Yeah.
Everyone assumed that was most likely why we had beards, because that's like the only people there that grow long beards. And both Kyle and I are like, no, I just think they're neat.
Yeah. Trying to tell them that they don't have a purpose was difficult. They stared at you like confused.
So this is a little example of the Ugandan countryside, along with those Buddha Buddhas, which are those motorcycles. They literally carry everything in them. I think that man is carrying some sheet metal on a Buddha Buddha in the picture right now. He's got a plate of sheet metal that's sticking out one side, like, way wings. Further than the other.
He's turning his Buddha Buddha into a plane. He just has to achieve velocity.
The worst that I saw was the rebar. That was so long that it was wrapped around the back, just
scraping on the ground and making sparks. It was something else.
Some guy had like 15 pieces of rebar folded in half, tucked around his waist, that was dragging on the road behind him. So if any car touched it, he would just get cut in half. That was...
It's dangerous as all get out. The motorcycles are something else to watch.
Yeah. And for the record, this is like the tamest bit of traffic that we saw. Some of the tamest near Kampala. Driving in there is absolutely wild. So these are kind of an example of some of the streets in the suburbs outside of the capital, so you can kind of see how crazy it is to just get around, and you kind of get an idea of kind of like what their streets look like. You might think, oh, this is kind of like just a this is the whole country, this is what the whole thing looks like right here. That is the football stadium that the government runs. And then you can kind of see some houses there in the front. Really typical just housing.
European or whatever football, that's soccer.
Yeah.
Yes, it's soccer, not American football. This was a picture on the side of one of the daycares, which has a bunch of razor wire or barbed wire at the top of it. Yep. Which was...
Also, they use the technique of putting wet cement on the top and then just shattering glass into it.
Yep.
Yes, just
a great
broken
great
glass
system.
Stuck into wet cement at the top of their walls to prevent people from coming over and getting in. This was a clothesline made of just barbed wire. It does come with... Hey, Shock, thanks for that sub, man. I appreciate it. It was pretty wild.
Yeah.
Pretty wild. We're kind of getting through a lot of the travel, at least initially, as we were heading out to Kigali, and this is getting us pretty close to Kigali here.
It's a nice tree.
Which is, kind of out in the wild. So this is the first picture that we have of Cornerstone Church. So this is the church that we taught in. No clothespin required. That's just good engineering. You're not wrong. this was the church. It's basically a dirt floor, cement slab up front, a metal roof, and some planks on the side for walls. And this is where we went for church on Sunday morning, and I taught on Sunday morning there. This is another picture. Greg got some really great pictures of Cornerstone, but just to give you an idea about what their church looked like, and also to give you an idea, like 70% of their congregation is children. It's like literally just all kids.
And they're all super well behaved.
Yeah.
Like, you wouldn't know.
Yeah. Just like...
This is not an American church.
No, not an American church. At all. Who is on her shirt?
Couldn't tell you that one.
Oh, I don't know. Just some other woman. just some other woman.
Whatever clothes they could get.
So they made us sit up front right in the seats of honor while we were there. So that's us sitting up front. This was during worship on Sunday morning, which is just a wild environment to be in because their services are like 3 hours long. And... the first like hour and 20 minutes at least is just
jumping and dancing.
Is just dancing and screaming.
As Mark had described it, there's no worship music. It's all praise the entire time.
Yep. Yeah, for the most part, it's just praise music. I'm gonna kind of sift through some of these photos as we go and talk about our time there. So, Doc, do me a favor, talk to me a little bit about like your experience initially inside of Cornerstone, because it was definitely a bit of a culture shock to do church there.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I've been to some church services like this from my time I've spent in like Jamaica doing some missions, but yeah, it definitely is a bit of a culture shock when you come in and like it is the loudest thing you've experienced. The fact that these people have any hearing left whatsoever is nothing short of a miracle. I'm pretty sure I have hearing damage from these services because everything is cranked to 10. All the music is cranked to 10. It's not uncommon to go for a 5 hour long service. Like that's normal.
Yeah. This is their Sunday school room. By the way,
so there you go. But the fact is like the people are all there, like are super, super engaged with the service and are like all in, praise and worship mode, like the whole time. And like, this is in the middle of the hot sun. And I mean, it's in a shed, right? This is not it's a church building with a dirt floor and a little bit of cement. And then it's just slapped together. They are planning on building a bigger building. You'll see some pictures later. There's a building next to it that they're making out of brick. So it'll be a more permanent solution for them. But I mean, this is like how many kids are at a church service. Like it's awesome to see. Like we would never have this many kids in an average church service. There you can see some of the brick building.
Go back.
Behind Greg in that picture.
Do you notice the girl in the front with the pink, pink sweater? That's Lynette. She was there that day.
Nuh-uh.
Yeah, that's her.
Is it her?
Yeah, right there. That's Lynette.
Trouble seeing her.
Yeah, for sure.
She was there and I didn't notice it?
Yeah, I didn't notice until I never saw her that day. But I was looking through the pictures like, what the heck? That's her. I didn't think, because you guys met up later.
Yeah, met at the school the next day.
The next day, yeah.
Interesting.
That's wild. That's wild. I did not know that. Yeah, so that brick building back behind is the building for the future transformation or Cornerstone Church. Sorry, Transformation Church is the one that's in Kampala. So for the record, they need about $15,000 or $20,000 to put a roof on this church so that it's usable right now. They can't worship in there because it has no roof. This is the dirt road that connects the church to the school. And then the next set of photos are us kind of showing up at the school. And on this Sunday, we got a chance to meet with the 73 orphans that live at the school itself. So this was us showing up, and it was kind of like, Kyle, talk a little bit about like those first impressions of showing up to the school, because that whole first experience is a little overwhelming as well.
Yeah, I was just thinking actually in a couple photos before this, when we were standing with that big group and he pointed out the one girl in the front, I remember feeling very uncomfortable because I don't know anybody yet. No one really knows you. They're all very much just staring at you. And that part didn't bother me, but it's a weird moment. So when we got that picture, it's kind of like, all right, let's stand here and everyone smile. And when you walk into the school, as we got there, it is truly something to look at, because it doesn't look like a school that we have. It doesn't feel like that, and there's so many kids watching you. It is definitely uncomfortable, and none of them really want to talk to you quite yet. One thing that culturally was very difficult for me at first is, out of respect for an elder, they lower their voice. Well, now they're talking low, and they have an accent, and they don't all speak very good English, so I cannot understand most of them. This is some pictures of us playing netball, which is the game that most of the girls play, because the boys play football. And we got to play with them, but they wouldn't tell us the rules. So at one point, Greg and I are out there, and we're just throwing the ball back and forth, and they're laughing at us because none of them will communicate the rules yet, because they're also uncomfortable with us. I mean, most of these kids probably have not seen a white person, let alone Doc and I with the beards. They really are excited to see, muscles. Oh, that was the death stork.
We'll spend some time with the death stork.
Being at the school was absolutely incredible, meeting all the kids, but at first, all the boys kind of stood off to the side and they don't want to talk to us. And all the girls are kind of coming over to you, but you're having trouble understanding them. So I found a lot of comfort in the older kids that were like 12 or so, because they would translate for the younger ones when they would talk too low. And that was really helpful.
Yeah.
So really quickly, some people in chat, and guys, keep commenting in chat or ask questions if you want.
Yes.
Alexander says, I'd love that. I would be exhausted after it, but I'd love it. Well, you should wait until you see what the worship service ended up like Thursday night, because we had to go to a dance party after it. Brenda says, I'd love to experience that. It was really powerful. Oof. Shock says, that'd be rough for me. Not the length of time necessarily, but the volume, though I could probably hear from a block away, so just hang out there. Well, they kind of force you to go up front right where the speakers are.
It's very intense.
You don't really have a choice.
It's very intense.
We're gonna play some footage of it later on. I'd probably have to be outside or further away to the doors till the sermon. But I enjoy it from a distance. Uniquely enough, the sermon was the loudest part. There was not a time where Ugandan pastor was not trying to break the speakers. The speakers were literally blown out every second, except when the Americans were preaching. I mean, it was just... Yep. That was it.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You'll hear that, too. You'll hear that. So the next picture is the death stork. Is there more than one?
The grudge stork.
The grudge.
Oh, the grudge stork. The beach hag. Yeah, so we had a running joke amongst the team about these truly, truly hideous...
They're huge.
...birds that are enormous, that are all over the place. Like goth birds
with a fancy shirt. Yeah. Goth. They're vile. They're vile to look at when you get close to them.
they're the worst.
They're called a marabou stork is like what their actual name is, but we came up with all the craziest names for them because... They just stand out in fields, like, with their wings out or just standing solemnly. They are a carrion bird, so yeah, breach. They are like vultures, so their head is completely, like, bald.
But they
and
eat more
like
trash.
Gunk.
They eat more like...
Yeah.
They're like
and
the...
souls.
And souls.
Souls and trash.
But they have a beak like a pelican, and the males have this giant, like, pouch that hangs off their neck that they inflate during mating season. So this is just this giant... fleshy pouch hanging off of them. That's very vile.
It's also a food storage and like digestion receptacle. So we pork food down into it.
Okay, enough of
also,
the
they are known to be able to eat an entire flamingo. They've been known to do that. So.
That's.
Oh, jeez.
And a soul.
Yep. So that Sunday, we got a chance to go into the market. So this is the town of Kigali, and this is the market, one of the markets. And we got to buy rice and sugar and salt, all kinds of supplies that we are then going to use to deliver to teachers and pastors and families that are in need of food. And so we got a chance to basically go collect a bunch of stuff. And that was day one in Kigali. Day two, we headed back to the school. That night on day one, we had packed all the bags, done like 70 bags or something like that. And this is a monkey. I think we have two pictures of the monkey.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just saw like wild monkeys just sort of like hanging out on the side of the road, just which was there. Cool. Yeah. There's monkeys. And then when we got to the school, I'm going to show you this in a minute, but before that, I'm going to show you this because when we got to the school, this is like 9 seconds, so it's not long. They met us with the Maisha Brass Marching Band. So I'm going to go ahead and throw that up and get a couple seconds of that. So we don't have a ton of footage of that, but that's a little bit of footage. That is how they literally received us at the school. So when we came in for the first time, all 450 kids were out in uniform waiting for us with the marching band playing. And then this was also the first time that I realized that Lynette was there, who is a little girl who I met 4 years ago whenever I was in Uganda before. And my wife and I have been supporting her financially for the past 4 years. And so this was my first chance to meet her in 4 years. She's now 8 years old. And so I got a chance to meet her while we were, you know, while we're doing that. And then we got a big tour of the school. Yeah. So this kind of gives an example of a bunch of the classrooms. And I don't know, Greg, if you want to narrate some of that or something.
Yeah, I mean, we'll have plenty of video that'll come out as we have time to develop and go through it. But the photos were something that we could share quicker. But yeah, we walked in. There was a ton of people playing for a very long time, too. They kept playing. They had a guy who was like spinning like this staff. He was really good at it. But then they took us on a tour through each of their classrooms. And so whenever they talk about their grades, they call them primary 1 through 7. And then they also have baby class, which would be like our kindergarten or preschool. And so they took us into each of the classrooms. In each classroom, they would all stand up at the same time, and they would sing and welcome us. And then they would announce as a group during their song what classroom they were. And then they would say, thank you for coming. Next time, do the same. It's like every single classroom, they had a very similar chant. But as you went up into the higher grades, they got a little bit more intricate with their welcome. They would sing and dance. Sometimes they had like a extra, I guess, lyrics to their welcoming song. It was really cool. Yeah, it was pretty special to be able to like be in their classrooms. And also the respect and honor that they had for the teachers. Like even though Robert Milley basically run the school, they started it and they have a large hand in it. They still took the time to tell the teachers thank you for allowing us to be in your territory. So little things like that were really
Greg,
cool to experience.
You want to talk about this little girl here who's in the front real quick, because you had a pretty strong connection with her while you were there.
Yeah, her name is Sandra. She has it was kind of hard to tell. She has something with her shoulders where they're just slightly I guess deformed. I don't know how I'd say it, but it didn't seem at any point like it was painful for her or really had any difficulty, but she was always smiling, and it was like one of those things where like she was just as much a student as all of the other students. Mm-hmm. But it was also cool to see her really kind of like usher in some of the younger kids. I noticed that like some of the younger students would come to her and she would share things with them, and so that was pretty cool. I think she's in P. I think that's, well, Davis is there. So is that P2 or P3?
I think they're still in P2.
Yeah, that would be P2.
The boy that we just saw there, his name is Davis. I'll talk about him later if we get a better picture of him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if we do. This is Lynette at the front of the room here for her P3 class.
She danced. She was one of the dancers.
She did a really good job dancing.
And we got to give every kid a suite while we were there, so big shout out to Bougie. One of the things that we got to do that day is we got to give every child a lollipop. And while we were there, those were bought by Bougie and sent by him. Mm-hmm. And then after we gave them a lollipop, we were able to go through and give several kids an extra suite who were doing really well in class or who had danced for the class or had done something special, which was cool. And then Greg got a couple of group photos. I think this is baby class one.
Yeah, I think so.
That Greg took a photo of. So he got to do some class pictures, which is really cool. But it gives you an idea. Like, look how freaking packed their classrooms are, guys. Like,
that's the biggest classroom. They have one teacher. At least that's the only time we saw. And there are 67 students in that class.
Yeah.
Like, just crazy packed.
As a slight rewind, I apologize. I saw Bootstraps threw something in chat about the supplies and everything. That you talked about money from the school/church. No, everything that came with us and food that we bought for giving out to the community, that all came from your guys' donations or some of the money that we brought as part of the missions trip. Because whatever our mission trip cost, Mark, you know, we all put a little bit of extra money in so we could take some cash in to buy food at the markets to take to families. So all the stuff we brought with us, if I'm not mistaken, is donations from you guys. But the stuff we bought in there was partly from donations and stuff that we had brought with us.
And actually, there was, I think, about $2,000 that was the board of Lux approved to put towards purchasing supplies and getting some of the remaining things that we needed. So some of the tithes and offerings from the church did come through to supply some stuff. So we bought a bunch of soap and toothbrushes and toothpaste with that money to take with us to be able to fill out the bags. So most of it was donated from y'all. Some of it was money that the board approved to be able to use to send stuff.
I also saw that Brenda Lutz there asked how many uniforms each student have. As far as I know, all the students have one uniform that the school supplies. So they actually are, their school originally, before we got there, their colors are red. But for whatever, Uganda believes that red brings on thunder, if I'm not mistaken, was mm-hmm. the cause. So they asked them to change the school colors. So there's a few students you will see without a school uniform. And it's because as money has been coming in, they've been then taking that money to buy uniforms for each of the kids. So most of the kids have switched to green, but they have not all gotten there yet because they're trying to change their school colors.
Yeah.
There's a couple pictures in there where they were like looking down. That's whenever we were sharing the family photos that Kyle had brought or that Corey had brought.
They gave me a really hard time because I don't even have a smartphone. So as I brought pictures printed out, these guys were giving me a hard time. Turned out to be the best thing for inside the classroom because you hand a phone around and all the hands go for the phone. But if you just hand the photos around, it was something really nice for the kids to pass around.
Yeah.
It's a Buddha Buddha. Yeah. sorry about that. So as we, I got a couple of moments to spend with Lynette while we were there the first day, and my wife and daughters filled a gift bag for her that they sent with us. And so I was able to just spend some time with just her and I. It turns out I was able to spend a lot of time just, with her throughout the course. Cool. But that was one of the cool things. It's really good to see that something as small as Lux has such a big impact, even minimally, when it comes to money. It warms mm-hmm. my heart that our family can still make a difference. Oh, man, a huge difference, yeah. Man. I'm telling you. The difference that you've seen is only scratching the surface. So these were meal bags that we were able to give one of to each of the teachers. Mm-hmm. And we'll have some video when we go out into the community to give some away.
But just so you guys realize that these teachers here, although they have jobs, Robert and Millie pretty much supply their salary as well. Many of them live at the school. They eat what the kids eat every day. You know what I mean? These are not teachers that we kind of think of that get away from the school. Most of them live there. As we were in several of the classes, the teachers have their babies with them. One of the babies attracted to me, which was kind of cool, so I got to take a 10-month-old around and just carried him for one of the days, just to give the teacher a break from the fact that she's changing a diaper while she's in charge of 40-some 5-year-olds or in that range. She's literally taking care of her baby while she's watching after 40 children. So it's a whole different environment in the school, but it feels like a family at the same time because she would just hand her baby to one of the older students, and one of the older students would take the kid to help out.
I think this is one of the larger school pictures that
Greg
was able to take. So you kind of get an idea about what the school's like and about how big it is, as that fence around the outside of it. And then for the record, you can see that fence in the background, just beyond it, you can see some buildings there. That is the home of the cult that dominates most of the religious and faith activity inside of Kigali. People have been going there for about 30 years and worshiping at a shrine there. The guy put up in honor of himself. I'll get into a little bit about that, but basically about a generation ago, this community still had a pretty bad problem with cannibalism, and supposedly the man who started the cult found a witch in the jungle who came back with herbs, and when came back with those herbs, he abolished cannibalism from the community and was able to perform some signs and wonders in addition to that, and then ended up starting a following that has been the major religion of Kigali ever since. So Maisha literally shares a fence with that cult, and they are the only Christian school in Kigali. Most of the rest of the schools in the community actually teach the teachings of that cult. I also saw Susie. Is there an official way to sponsor a child there? There will be, and we'll talk about that at the end of the stream. But just to kind of give you an idea of some of, these are the kids' faces, but also some of the spiritual darkness that was there. And then that day, we went out and began giving supplies to families who had children or were neighbors of families who had children in the school, which was an incredibly, maybe one of the most eye-opening and impactful experiences that we had. So these are some of the homes that we went to. Doc, I'm going to have you share in a minute what your experience was in that first hut that we went to. We also saw this hornbill, which was super cool. And this is just some of the pictures of Ugandan countryside as we were out in the vehicle dropping off these meals. There's a bunch of random photos. I'm going to go ahead and show a video real quick of us dropping off a meal. And then, Doc, when we come back, I'm going to have you share about that first couple houses that we went to, what that experience was like.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. So you've been saying that you enter the house and pray for him a blessing.
And Janet, to answer your question, no, they did not know that we were coming. But go ahead, Doc, talk a little bit about that experience that night.
Yeah, going out into the community, and we went out pretty far into the community. It was a miracle that Robert could drive this van on some of these roads to get out there. But this is where you kind of got to see a little bit of how most of the people in this area live. They are miles from clean water, so they're gonna have to walk every day to try fill up some kind of bucket with water or a barrel. Some of them have rain barrels, most of them do not. Most of these people have a mud hut that is put together with dirt and sticks. Every once in a while they have a single tiny solar panel that is on their roof that powers a single light bulb. That is about the extent of some of their ability to develop it, and that's kind of rare, right? That's when you get closer to the actual city. The first house we went to, there was a man living there. He appears to have most likely been crippled from birth. He literally walks on his hands. His feet are completely folded underneath him, so he has zero use of his legs. He was a father of, I think, was it 5 children?
Yeah.
He is a father of 5 children. He still works outside doing what he can on a small grove of trees that you can kind of see behind his house. And one of the children that was there at the house was there that day because wasn't going to school because that he was HIV positive. So you're really starting to see these families that they are extremely struggling. And it's wonderful to be able to help them. However, it's also sobering to know that despite the amount of help that we can give in that moment, there's only so much we can do for each family. And those times are very hard, especially when you see children that have distended stomachs because they're starving. We do what we can in those moments, but it's a sobering fact of some missions that there's a lot of these kids that aren't going to be there when we come back next year. Our hope and our prayers are that they can keep getting resources, assistance, but it's just a difficult time going to these communities, but they are all very welcoming, and we took time and we prayed over each family. Now, we were all praying in English. They probably didn't know what we were saying. Maybe they did through the prayer, but for us to spend time and be there as a presence and a presence of hope for them as much as we could. And yeah, it was definitely one of the most powerful days we had there. It's also the most difficult day I think we had there.
Yeah.
For me, at least.
Yeah, it was really hard.
Yeah, Kyle or Greg, anything you want to chime in with? That day in particular, I remember texting back home that night and saying today was really good and really hard.
Yeah. Going through those homes, it was probably the fourth or fifth home we got to. Is the one that's really burned in my memory was a woman who had a baby tied to her back to carry, and she had two, I'm pretty sure, were little girls there. And the baby is naked, and the two little girls both just have nothing but a shirt. And I couldn't tell their ages because you don't know by how big they are. But just by their eyes as they're watching you, yeah. That's a really hard photo to look at.
Talking, but this is the photo from that house.
But that was a little boy that was standing right outside the house. I don't know if sure that was her older son or just another kid that showed up. But it was really, really difficult being at that home. Because she looks at you, but not really. There's just a presence when you're there that is indescribable until you're there. Something I didn't know. Greg's going to show a picture of her.
Yeah, in the little window on my phone.
Yeah, and it was a really, really difficult thing when we were there. We got a chance to discuss it after we left, because there was a couple homes where the whole feels entirely different. Everyone's grateful that you're giving them food, but a couple of the homes we went to, they kind of come out to greet you. They have taken care of the few trees around their home, because almost all of the trees produce some sort of food, whether it's a banana tree or a mango tree, things like that, coffee beans. And those families that you could tell were taking care of their home, even though they had almost the same exact thing the other people did, they came out, and the one lady I distinctly remember, she has four or five kids there. Some of them are older. And she made a point to walk into her home and give us a bag of tomatoes when she's barely feeding her own family out of thankfulness. And we were able to take those tomatoes and just go to the next home who needed food and give them some. But it was just like there was a difference between certain homes. The first couple homes we walked into, there was a picture on the wall of Jesus. At some point, it looked like a Catholic group of something had come around and given things out, because it was very, very looked much like a Catholic Jesus. Mm-hmm. With a heart on his chest. And you could tell by those homes did not know him. There was no presence of the Lord there in a sense. But the other homes where some of those families had actually gone to the churches or their kids were going to the school, there was a different feel in that home. And it's amazing just that little bit of difference between two families who live on the same road, live in the same country, but yet totally different lives. It was really, really difficult in being in some of those areas.
One of the things that you actually could hear at the end of the video that we showed, where we give the guy the bag of supplies, he asks for us to go in and pray for him inside of his home, because he wanted the blessing to be in his house. Mm. Like, he was afraid that if we were to pray for him outside, that the blessing wouldn't stay upon his home. And I know that's something little, but like, even just valuing where it was that we prayed, he wanted it to be in his house so that the Lord and his presence would stay there with his family. Like, little things like that, you noticed just through conversation, the way that they view things spiritually, was pretty cool, to see in the aspects where, like, they were asking for us to pray over particular things, in their life. But it was also kind of, like, haunting whenever you would notice, like Kyle said, there's, like, a difference, in the families that didn't know the Lord. And we'll talk about it later with some of the stuff that we did later. But we essentially did a second round where we brought bags to the community and invited them out to the conference. And we'd also share the gospel with them. A lot of times, just very quickly, we'd share it and then invite them out to Cornerstone. And they were almost always receptive to, like, just sit there and hear. And, like, a lot of people, like, they would, like, you could tell they were just hungry, like, for something new and for something real.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll talk a little bit about that. Gamer Medic asks, in terms of mission trips and reporting on it, are these people presented to be pitied for us to have compassion on? If the latter, how do we put that into action? I know when I did my last one, they said they didn't want to be pitied. They wanted to be encouraged for others due to their faith, despite their struggles and what they have. And I will say this, I mean, what we found in Uganda was people without a lot of physical possessions, but with a great spiritual strength. And certainly when you go there initially, you might feel like these people need help, or, you know, we're coming with answers. But I told the team before we went, and once we were there, that that's not the way that you'll leave. Like, you might go there with that interaction at first, but by the time you leave, you won't want to go. And it won't be because you're like, I need to stay here and help these people. It'll be because you've learned to love them, and you've learned to love their country, and you've learned to love their culture, and you won't want to leave it. And I think for all of us, we all had that experience, right? All of us were saying, we need to go back. All of us were saying, we're ready to go home because we want to see our families. We want to see our loved ones, but we don't want to go home. We don't want to leave Africa. And so I certainly don't pity them. But I do view them as my brothers and my sisters. And yes, well, in terms of compassion and the ability to take action, we're gonna give you some of that tonight as well, by the end. Absolutely. So let's continue. That was the hardest day, I think, emotionally for the team. But it got a little bit better the following day. So these are just some closing pictures. The following day, the school got to go to a football game and netball competition between them and all of the other schools. And once again, they're the only Christian school in the district, so every team literally roots against Myesha. And so we got to go and be the four large white male mascots.
Three large and a medium.
Wow.
I know that Greg's a medium, because when I was out of clothes, I tried to borrow his, and that was not going to work.
And so we just got to celebrate with the teams. We have a whole bunch of pictures. I think Greg became a genuine sports photographer while we were there. Who is this little girl? Because Greg, you connected with her too.
Yeah, that's Siobhan. She, and I didn't realize this until like the last day, literally like as I was saying goodbye. She's the daughter of one of the teachers at the school. I think she's primary two or three. Yeah, that day was whenever she first kind of started trying to get my attention, and that was the photo of her waving to me as I was on top of the van.
So we got to celebrate. This is a netball course that they have there, and so we got to kind of celebrate with the girls playing netball. How burnt was the mini milkman by the end? amazingly enough, none of us really got burnt. Yeah, you didn't tan.
Temperature stayed under 85 the whole time we were there. It was pretty crazy. It wasn't that hot.
I think it was hotter than that.
Was it?
88. Yeah, 88, 90.
Yeah, I think we were high 80s, low 90s.
Okay,
during the heat of the day. Yeah, during the heat of the day. This girl here is actually, this is the back of Val.
Yep, that's the back of Valerie.
Yeah, she's, I think, a couple pictures prior.
She is a girl that I really connected with, who we'll talk about later, but I get the privilege and honor of supporting her from here. She is a beautiful soul. She's 13 years old. The reason I connected with her is as they tried to feed me mangoes, she took my knife from me and helped me peel it because I was doing a terrible job of it. but she's an incredible person that I'm excited to hopefully see when I go back.
Yeah. And these are a couple pictures of me. I just got a chance to spend a little bit of time with Lynette on top of the van during the football game, which was really great. Then we got to watch the boys play football, which was awesome.
Incredible.
And holy cow, are they good. I'm going to shift through some of these because Greg got a lot of really cool pictures.
This was like one of the only times that Robert made a request. I was on top of the van, which you can see in the background of that shot prior. And I was up there sitting with him, and as the team's walking out onto the field, he's like, I really wish you'd be down there to get them from the field. And so I jumped off the van and ran up barefoot and was just taking pictures of them while they're on the line getting ready to start.
But you can see that's their goalposts as they caught the one shot is just pieces of wood, and the whole field is slanted.
Yeah.
This is, you
right
know.
Right there. You can see the goalpost.
Yeah, that's the goalpost. And these kids can play. I mean, it is. They're doing headshots and stuff. And
half of them are barefoot.
Yeah, because there's only two kids in our entire team had cleats, and they're allowed to wear them. So they're running around with cleats while most of the other team and their own team is barefoot. Like, it is incredible what they're doing out there.
Yeah, they're taking balls to the head at like 6 billion miles an hour.
It is intense.
Yeah, these kids are tough. Like, I think all of our youth sports could take a page out of their book because these kids just get domed in the head with a soccer ball, and our soccer games would be put on hold for like 30 minutes. These kids just shake it off and they just keep playing. They don't even pause the game.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Yeah. Really, really, really cool.
I like
cool.
this series. He's like winding up.
Yeah. You got him running towards the ball, got him going towards the ball, and
and then it's just gone.
Wham.
Yeah,
it's gone.
Dude, they hit so hard. One thing I wanted to
did they win? Yeah, they did. We actually got to run onto the field and scream and shout, Maisha, Maisha, Maisha with them. And, like, there's literally kids just rolling around on the ground.
Every shot the kids are rolling around. Every time they score a goal, they just storm the field. It's great. Something was interesting here. So Maisha, of course, had met us now for about 2 days. So those kids weren't as enamored with us. They want to be around us. They want to hold our hands. But you would turn around and there's 120 pairs of eyes staring at you because all the other schools that are there have not seen you. So you would turn around to just eyes glued to you from every side, just staring. And it was kind of a wild feeling.
Well, and many of them have never seen a white person before, right? Like, this was their very first time ever seeing a white person. These are some shots just from around the school. We got to go back.
That's Shakira.
The following day, that's Vicky and Val.
Yeah.
Those are my two girls. That's Valerie, we talked about, and her younger sister, who's 8. Her name is Victoria. They call her Vicky.
Yeah. And so we got a chance just to kind of go back and hang out with the kids. Who's the little girl in the red dress?
Oh, that's Siobhan.
That's Siobhan.
She would stand around and wait for me, and then when she would see me, she would smile and then just like do like this waddle run towards me until she would catch up and then hold my hand.
Hoping we have a shot of Davis. I wanted to discuss about him for a moment if we do.
So all the kids have chores, and so a lot of them will, you know, spend some of their time doing chores. Greg got some really good pictures of some of the little ones.
It's incredible.
Here. Some really, really great pictures.
There's Sandra.
Yeah.
There's Sandra, yeah. Just some really great pictures of the kids. This is them now knowing how to play netball, returning to actually play netball, which was really...
It's basically ultimate frisbee with a basketball, if you're wondering what it's like.
Yeah, that's basically what it is. And then we would just spend a lot of time...
That is the baby boy who's the teacher. He's actually a twin of the teacher that really decided he liked me, and he literally would follow me, so I had him on my lap for a good bit.
Yeah. You can see how big Siobhan is. She's pretty tiny.
Yeah, she's very little. Because Greg's the smallest of us, so. So this was my favorite and least favorite moment. So Lynette, when we were in town, I was able to buy her a dress and shoes. And it was something that she was, you know, never able to get on her own, never able to have on her own. So she got to put it on and pose, and, you know, was just kind of the talk of the school for the afternoon, which was really cool. And I got to hang out with her and some of her friends throughout the course of that, which is just really, really powerful. The part that made this hard was that night we learned that Lynette's father had left the family again, and she was living with her stepmom, and her stepmom hated her and was using her as a slave. So we had not known this until then, but Lynette was getting up every day at 5:30 in the morning in the dark and hiking multiple kilometers to get water and bring them back to the house. And then she was cooking for her brothers and dressing her brothers and getting them to school, coming to school exhausted, coming home from school and getting beaten by her stepmom most nights. The part that was really hard was that her stepmom beat her the night that she came home in this dress because she had received attention from an American. The neighbors said it was like a war zone at her home that night. And she had also been beaten for the gift that we had sent, but my wife and kids had sent with me to bring her. And so it was this night that I found out that she was just really trapped in a hellhole. And so that began the burden on my heart to make sure that while I was there that Lynette would be safe. And so it was really disheartening. At the same time, it was a really cool moment. It was one of those other days that was really, really good and at the same time was really, really bad. There's Siobhan, and that story's not over, so we'll finish it by the end. That's not the little boy that you were talking about, right, Kyle?
No.
I don't think so. That dude has the biggest smile, though. Like the biggest smile.
We definitely have pictures of him, but
Davis will be in there.
Yeah. So this was Greg displaying to the kids how cameras work, and he was going like a full description in his bag of all of his lights and everything. And this was at nighttime, so this was just the orphans that we were able to be with, which was really cool to just have time with them when school wasn't on.
That's Valerie beside me there in the black coat. I would continually make fun of the children when they would put coats on because I, in the middle of the night, am still sweating, and they are putting on coats because they're saying it's cold because it's 75 at night. And I was like, you guys are crazy. So I gave them, you know, I had a lot of fun, like, picking at them for putting coats on.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really cool. While you were glad you found out what was going on, while you were able to do something about it, who knows how much of that you'd been giving her. Even got to her. Yeah. Well, the money that I have sent would never go directly to Lynette. It would go to the school, which was the money that was used to keep the school afloat, which also helped to keep Lynette in school clothes and, you know, giving her a couple of meals a day. So this was the night, this was like late that one night, whenever we had the dance party. But before I go to that, we never really talked about the conference. So for three nights in a row, we did a conference. Night one, I preached. Night two, Kyle and Doc preached. And night three, Greg and I preached. And on the final night, the worship service went about 5 hours long. And at the very end of the night, like, we saw wild stuff. So that night, there was a woman who came who was very clearly possessed by an evil spirit, flailing, like throwing two full-grown men around during the worship service, where we stopped to pray over her. And so we were praying over people. The ministers from Uganda were praying over people. And so we were coupling these daytimes where we were with the kids with these nighttimes where these crazy supernatural spiritual things were going on. People were giving their life to Jesus, just absolutely wild. And so at the very tail end of that, we had a couple of videos of giving you an example of what worship was like. Just heads up, this won't be quiet, but a couple of videos of what worship was like on the last evening that we were there. There's two of them, so I'll play this one and then the second.
This is where my
So just roughly 3 hours of that with 2 hours of preaching.
Yep. Literally you're up moving that many people, and the floor is dirt. So that cloud you see is the dust we are tasting.
Yes.
The entire time.
Yeah, it was the worship there was quite the event.
He just said he said grab something and wave it, and so everyone just had like trash.
There was a bunch of boys that came in from the school, and they snuck in around the side of the building that all took their shirts off and were just going nuts. Like it was something else. That went on for 15-20 minutes.
Corey and Mark were just waving their phone. They just had their phone in their
hand. It's literally the only thing I had in my pocket was my phone.
But
that
was a 5-hour conference of intense spiritual warfare and dancing.
So, mm-hmm. Doc, why don't you talk a little bit about what happened at the school after that? Because that was over at like 10 p.m., and we still had a lot of night ahead of us that Thursday.
Yeah, so we got done with that conference. We then, you know, kind of packed some of our stuff up, and we walked with a bunch of the kids from Myesha back to the school. So we're walking in the dark. I literally just have like my little pocket flashlight lighting the way. Because when it gets dark in Uganda, it gets dark. And we get back there, and they took a bunch of the sound system in the vehicle from the church and brought it back to Myesha. So the beauty of living in a country where there are basically no laws is you can be as loud as you want, whenever you want, however long you want. It doesn't matter. So because what are your neighbors going to do? Nothing. So we set up a sound system and started doing dance parties with these kids. So I was taking a few of these photos. All the other guys were doing some dancing. I eventually got involved. There are moments here that I have never felt, for lack of a better term, more white in my life than being asked to dance in front into actual like Ugandan dance music. And there was a bunch of that throughout. It was really fun. We taught them the Macarena. We taught them the cha-cha slide, all the terrible, terrible dances that are at every single American wedding. Everyone got out for chainsaw. That was a great
exhausting
one. There is the dance. I don't know if there is an explanation. It just is. Shayna.
We were doing any white person dance we could come up with.
Yes. But the big thing was this was a celebration essentially for Millie's birthday. Mm-hmm. So we kind of came back. There was music. We had gone into town earlier to get like, you know, some soda and some ice cream. Thankful for the guy at the hotel we were staying at. His name was Peter. He was a guy. So he overheard us talking about wanting to celebrate and getting ice cream. And he's like, hey, how much ice cream do you need? I can hook you up. And so he gave us an estimate for price, and he called a Buddha that showed up with ice cream. It just worked out. And that it was awesome to get to spend time with these kids. And once we started getting them out and to like actually play with us, it was powerful. And this is all happening after we just spent 5 hours worshiping, praising, listening to sermons, and having some of the most intense prayer with hundreds of people. Like it just kept going. Like, I don't know where the energy was coming from, but because it wasn't from me. And it was awesome. And you'll see some pictures as we go here. Is Millie at the end, there'll be a birthday cake she gave. And yeah, here's her cake that someone got made for her. And of course, the first thing that Millie does after cutting the cake up and we all sang happy birthday is she took her time to make sure every single student that was there got a piece before her, because mm-hmm. that's Millie and Robert's heart, right? That is the epitome of who Millie is like, this is an awesome celebration in honor of me. I'm going to spend it serving. Like, she spent most of this evening in back over a hot fire cooking all of the food for the kids. We didn't even know this because she just disappeared mm-hmm. and didn't have, we had, I would have offered to help like do some of that, right? But no, this is just how she wanted to celebrate. Here they're literally doing party poppers. And you know, they took a soda, like I think it was it Tony
and
took a soda and just like shook it and just blasted everybody, because you know that's how you celebrate apparently. Here you go. Here you see a picture of Millie down making sure every kid gets a piece. And yeah, It was a fantastic evening. I wouldn't trade it for anything.
And just for the record, so you guys are aware, that evening, Millie was in charge of doing the closing time of ministry, so that's praying over people. Just before that, Millie had found out the case that she had been working on with a man who had been sexually abusing three young girls, and she had got him convicted of the crime. I can't even go into details of it here. The stuff that was going on with these three young women is so horrendous that I can't talk about it on live stream. She found out that the Ugandan government, the judge who had likely been bribed, did not take this man's passport as he was awaiting sentencing. She found out moments before going on stage that this man had left the country and would now get away with his crimes. After that happened, she had a crippling spiritual attack that resulted in a horrible, horrible headache that almost literally impaired her. Like, she almost could not function. While she had that headache, she got on stage and she led the time of prayer where she prayed over people. We saw people slain in the spirit. We saw people freed of spirits by her hand. And then she left the conference, walked to the school, and she prepared a meal for 73 children by herself over a fire, and then shared her birthday cake with all of the children before she took any.
Unreal.
So to give you an idea of the quality of character of these of this couple, Robert and Millie, that our church is going to be actively partnering with, there really isn't a comparison in terms of the character and the Christ-likeness that this woman and this man have. It's unlike I have ever seen anybody in my entire life. The selflessness, the sacrifice is insane. And so we really can't say enough about Robert and Millie and their ministry.
Like, when unbelievable. When you hear somebody say, like, they should be able to, like, people should be able to know that you follow Christ because of the way that you live, like, they genuinely imbue that. Like, there is something about them, and that something is because they follow the Lord with their entire being. Like, there is something about them that is just, like, completely different than anybody else that I've ever met.
Yeah. I mean, just some of the most powerful, and I mean, this is the world that they live in every single day of their life. So, you know, when we come back and we say, hey, we want our church to financially get behind what Robert and Millie are doing, we don't say that casually. We say that because we have firsthand experience with two of what may be the most amazing servants of Jesus on the planet, who are literally saving the life of hundreds of children in Kigali, who would end up as street kids or sex slaves if it wasn't for Robert and Millie and what they're doing. And so powerful. Now, this coupled with Friday, when we had to leave, and on Friday we were going to do baptisms, and so we decided to do baptisms. We got two vans, we loaded it full of the Ugandans who had accepted the Lord at the conference and wanted to be baptized, about a dozen of them, and Kyle and Doc were also going to be baptized. And we drove for about 40 minutes on red roads, Druzy, thanks for the prime, appreciate it, on dirt roads. When we came up to what I said was, haha, jokingly, I bet we're going to do the baptisms here. Because it was a small creek that was running under a small wooden bridge. And on the other side of that bridge was a young boy watering five cows. And there was cow crap literally everywhere. And sure enough, that's where we pulled over the car to do the baptisms. Luckily, we didn't do the baptisms under the cows. We did it 20 foot down creek, after a small rock outcropping in a shallow pool of filthy water that looked like it had an oil slick on top of it because of all of the disintegrated cow feces that were in it. It was un-freaking believable. When we went down, Robert scooped up water off the rock. He sniffed it and said, we're good to go. Just make sure people close their eyes, close their mouth, and hold their nose. In other words, do not let this water in any part of your body. But we're good. It was literally surrounded by trash. The water was so dark that I could not see the bottom of the 2-foot pool, and I had to go into it barefoot in front of everybody else to circle. We've gone full circle back to the poop pipe water. I'm telling you guys, I was like, I cannot believe we are going to baptize people. But here we are, baptizing Ugandans in the pool of water, one after the other. One woman did come down to be baptized without a top on.
The picture's not in here.
Completely topless.
There's no picture.
We are not going to include that picture.
I didn't even take the picture.
But it was very funny watching Mark have to handle that.
Yeah, I thought it was just kind of like a cultural thing, and so it was like a National Geographic moment. But then Robert told me later that it was completely abnormal and should not have happened. So, but he thought it was hilarious that it happened to me.
You can see that water's only that deep, and you can't see their knees, even though he's wearing shorts, because it's so cloudy. Yes,
it was pretty cloudy. So we got a chance to baptize all of these native Ugandans, and then we have a little video of Kyle and Doc's baptism. You can't really hear it. Oh, hold up. Do I need to restart this video?
Yes. What is your full name?
Corey Thomas Lundin.
And who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
Relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, you seek for the life of the Father.
I do.
Amen. Corey Thomas Lundin, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So here we got the chance to baptize. Obviously, you could basically only hear water in that shot, but we got the chance to baptize both Doc and Kyle while we were in Uganda, and that's me and Tony who were doing the baptisms. Really powerful. Could we get some fives in chat for two more baptisms here at Lux? Just really, really, really cool. Doc, I'll let you go first, then Kyle. What was it like to know that you were going in that water?
You know, I didn't let me share my, yeah, I'm not muted. It was like, yeah, as Mark said, it was that moment of like, oh no, like what's going to happen? But it was interesting because Robert reminded us afterwards of the passage from Acts where Philip baptizes the Ethiopian. And he talked about how when they were getting baptized, like the Ethiopian asked, he wanted to be baptized, that there was an oasis nearby, which an oasis in biblical times is not this beautiful landscape of pristine blue water and palm trees. It's probably this, because it's where you would bring a camel to drink. And he's like, yep. And they just did it. Right. And so I think that's kind of like that. It was just like, yeah, we're going to do it. I mean, I was in here. Like, I did not realize. I thought I emptied my pockets. I still have my passport strapped onto my back when I did that. Because, you know, I was going to go in. And like for me, like I was baptized as an infant, but it is something that, you know, was on my heart as like baptism is that public affirmation of faith, that public facing thing that no one can deny. And that's kind of what I wanted to do. And when I talked with Mark, I was like, yeah, let's do it in Uganda. Because why not? And yeah, it was incredibly powerful. Kyle, anything for you?
Yeah. I mean, we got there and of course immediately I could hear Mark being like, you're not serious. We're not doing this here. And then when they say we are serious, we get down to where the pool of water is. It was so funny. We're like, oh, we're not doing it here. It's right down there. Like, oh, cool. 15 yards downstream. You know, and, Mark had kind of offered, you guys don't have to do this here if you don't want to. And I definitely was on the fence for a moment because, you know, they really pounded into me, don't drink any of the water in Uganda, and you're going to go under. But I had a really incredible spiritual moment and day two of the conference for me. And I want to kind of be clear. I am not spiritually equipped in any way to push out spirits and watch what was going on. So it was a very overwhelming experience for me. But even in those moments, hard to describe, but the Lord stepped into my life on the second day of the conference. And I thought, where else would I do it? Where the Lord approached me and the Holy Spirit approached me somewhere where I have not been approached in America. You know, so I was like, why would I say no to this moment? So that's why I did it. And I can't say that when I came out of the water, I felt like a dove was descending upon me or something, but it was that act of being in the place where I was touched by the Holy Spirit.
Well, thanks for sharing, Kyle.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really, really powerful. Really, really powerful. And I had cuts on my feet, and I still have my feet. So when I take you to Uganda with me, guys, and you want to be baptized, we're just going to do it in the poop water. For the record. For the record, it's going to be in the poop water. So this was the group that was baptized. These were all the Ugandans that were baptized along with Kyle and Doc. Really, really powerful moment on that Friday afternoon. Man, really, really cool. On our way out of town, we were heading towards our time at the National Forest and going on the short safari that we went on. We got to visit the maize mill. And so when I was there 4 years ago, we purchased a field for them to grow maize in, which is just basically field corn. And this is the mill that was, and they got the money donated to build. This is what they use to feed the kids at the school most of the time, which is maize flour, just ground corn, usually with water and some sugar. And so this is the maize grinding mill that we helped put together, which is really, really cool. Not this church, Luxton, but the church that I was part of previously. This is us on our way towards the Savannah and the Nile River in Uganda, which was a really powerful experience, and it's really encapsulated well by this video.
Lights out at 7 o'clock.
Okay. Maybe not captured perfectly well.
Got him.
But absolutely hilarious.
I'm a professional. I'm really good at taking videos.
Yeah. So on our way in, who asked? Was it you, Doc, or Kyle that asked?
It was me. It was 100% me.
Doc.
Yeah.
Doc
asked.
I was
like, I want to get on top of the van.
Can we get on top of the van? So just for the record, when you get into the Ugandan National Forest, it's about an hour and 15-minute drive through the jungle before you can get to a hotel. And once you get to the hotel, you are in the middle of the Ugandan wilderness, and then you have another 15-minute drive to get to the Nile River. You cross the Nile River and then go on to the savannah where you do your safari drive. So for that hour and 15 minutes, the four of us sat on the top roof rack of the van and just soaked in the Ugandan wilderness. We saw bunches of baboons along the road.
It was incredible.
We're in the setting African sun. Freaking believable in terms of how beautiful it was. Slightly technical as a majestic view of that beard. Amen.
There was this moment when it just opened up, and I think everyone was just like,
we stopped talking and
you just looked around.
We came over like a hill,
yeah,
and you saw like the entire like nature preserve in front of you with the sun setting off to the distance, and there's just no words. Like there's not a single picture, no matter how good of a photographer Greg is, that will encapsulate
that
sensation. Yeah.
Although a couple of them come pretty freaking close.
Yeah.
So the next morning we woke up and we got on the safari vehicle. This is us crossing over the Nile River. You're gonna see some animal pictures because we got to see some really cool animals while we were there. So this is like some sort of a deer creature.
Something kind of my side note. Interesting. My son informed me of this as we talked about. That was we crossed over the River Nile. It's called the Nile Victoria because it flows out of Lake Victoria. That is the birth of the Nile. That is where the Nile starts, is at Lake Victoria, which was something that my son got to tell me today, which was pretty cool.
Mm. So just some beautiful pictures of the landscape. We got to see some pretty cool animals while we were there. And then about 15 to 20 minutes in, we came across a herd of wild African elephants, which was probably the highlight of our time together. And so, I don't know, there was probably 15 or 20 of them that were there, which was really incredible. And then Greg got these pictures of the one that was like 30-some foot from our car.
If that.
I mean, look at these freaking photos that Greg got. This is just literally wild African elephant. Also, the nation of Uganda should hire Greg to make their advertisements because this is way more convincing than any of the other things Uganda has. freaking unreal. This is a baby elephant. Because there were several baby elephants in the herd, which was really, really cool. little elephant. Really, really cool. So Greg, being the amazing photographer, this is like pre-edit, guys. This is pre-photography edit shots that Greg got of these elephants, which was so cool. So freaking cool. we probably saw, I don't know what, we have 40 pictures left. We probably saw like 100 giraffes. We saw so many giraffes.
The giraffes were way more popular than I thought. The other thing that we saw was, which I think there might be a picture or two of one here, but was the Cape Buffalo. We saw 200 of them. They were absolutely everywhere.
These are stupid birds.
Yeah, they would not move out of the way of the vehicle at all.
Those are the willow of birds.
That's a herd. That is literally a herd of Cape Buffalo running away from us here through the grassland.
Yeah.
Which is...
How many more pictures of this do we have?
Handful.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, something I wanted to mention as we talked pretty highly of this. It was really cool to see all this. When we got through it all, there is not a single one of us who all four of us had said we would have given up this safari to stay at Maisha's school and orphanage for another 2 days. I was really grateful to be able to do this, and seeing these animals was really neat because it's genuinely wild animals in the middle of the wilderness. I mean, you're on these dirt roads that some of the trucks are having trouble to go on. So it was a great experience that we had on the trip. I would have stayed at that school with those children for another 2 days.
Yeah. These pictures literally don't look real. these pictures that Greg got, that looks completely not real. But yeah, I agree. Every one of us would have given up the safari for another day with the kids. The easiest way to get into Uganda right now is through a tourist visa. And you kind of have to have something touristy on your agenda to apply for a tourist visa. Yeah. We thought, while in Africa, why don't we go see African wildlife? But once we were there, although it was something we were all pretty excited about, once we were there, we were all like, yeah, we wish we were with the kids. Greg, you are amazing. Thank you for using your gifts. I got so proud of you, my mom says.
Thank you, Brendan.
And a proper David, I don't know that last name. He must be like...
Attenberg. He's the guy who does...
Attenborough.
Attenberg, yes, or whatever it is. He does the Blue Planet Life, Planet Earth.
Oh, I don't have his voice. But here we see a wild dog making his way to the Nile River. He hopes to successfully cross the river unscathed and hunt down his mark, an elephant. He will not eat it, only observe and stroke his beard.
These were the ones that we got really close to.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is a funny story. Mark and Greg get out to go get closer to these giraffes because they were not very far away. And they start going a little further out, and they go a little further out to get a closer picture. They're getting, 25, 50 yards away from the vehicle, and our guide in the vehicle is like, you might want to tell your friends to not go any further. And I was like, oh, they're going to come back soon. He's like, hey, it's their life. And he puts his hands up. It's the wild. It's their life. And he's dead serious because we didn't get to see any lions, but they were very much so looking for lions the entire time we were there.
Yeah. Bougie said, doing some father things that I missed the candy discussion. So you did a long time ago, actually, Bougie. So we showed all of the classrooms that we gave out candy in on our first full day in Kigali, which was a really cool experience and was such a huge blessing. You don't know how big of a deal sweets are to these kids. And so being able to give the kids sweets was a massive thing for them. So this is Millie and this is Robert. And the next day is their anniversary, actually, 7-year anniversary. I would die trying to pet things. That's correct. That is.
Yeah, the hippos are really friendly.
If you tried to pet them, correct, you would die.
We didn't get close to the hippos.
But I do want to share a brief story. We were, I left my camera in the tour vehicle once we got to, the place where everyone was stopped. And there was a bunch of hippos out in the water. Well, we were all getting up closer. And then people are up there with their phones, zooming in, digitally cropping to zoom in. And I out loud said, I love how all these people are just zooming in on their phones. Wow, what a great 8 pixels. And then this guy who's standing next to us turns around and looks at me. And I was just kind of tired at that point. Yeah. I didn't really care what I said. Yeah. And then he
immediately proceeded to zoom out.
Yeah, zoom out his phone. It was super funny. There also was this lady who got down to take a video of the warthog that actually is the warthog in this picture.
Yeah.
Because it was pretty close to the vehicles walking around, and she kept getting closer and just paying attention to her phone and not the fact that the warthog was getting increasingly closer to it till she screamed. And the warthog is less than 5 feet and half charged her and then turned around and ran. I was like, if this lady gets gored by a warthog in front of us, I'm gonna lose it. It was just such a white touristy thing to do, to like not pay attention to the fact that the wild animal you're filming is coming at you.
Yeah. It was a wild day. So here's the thing. We did all this stuff. The next day, well, actually the same day that we did the safari, we drove the whole way back to Kampala, about 5 or 6 hours. Gorsar in 10 pixels. I once was a one warthog. And so that night, the next day we spent all day in Kampala with the kids at Robert and Millie's house, getting to know them and spending time with them, all kind of ready to go home. But that night... they threw a party for Robert and Millie's anniversary and Millie's birthday. We bought sodas for the kids and a cake for Millie. And for like multiple hours, the kids did dances and gave speeches to Robert and Millie in celebration of their anniversary and us being there in their birthday. And this incredibly clever, beautiful young woman was making up these most ridiculous stories and then calling up random people to dance.
Yep.
And we did not know this, but we were all going to get called up to dance individually in front of everybody, which we all did. I think that Greg was the best. Kyle was the goofiest. And I was the shortest dancing up there, for sure. But it was fantastic. We had a lot of fun. And at the end, they told us that at midnight, we're going to party like Ugandans. And they said, are your phones out of your pockets? And we said, yes. Now, we knew they were planning on putting water and dumping it on Millie. And the young woman said, it is uncontrollable. And I question how uncontrollable it actually was. Because just for the record, here's a little bit of what we looked like about 5 minutes after we started partying like Ugandans. And by the way, Robert hid inside his house and locked us outside.
And then recorded it.
Totally and completely out of control.
And that was only after they had rubbed icing over all of us.
Yeah, as soon as the cake was cut, they grabbed handfuls of icing and went to town.
Yep. So that was a very it was a very interesting evening. Despacito in the background.
It was the only American song that they played the entire time.
Which
we were
was
there.
A Spanish song.
Yeah, it's like, well, it was the only song I knew from America. Okay.
It was the only American song clearly in Spanish.
And then the entire night, they had two trumpets, two different people playing trumpets on either sides of the...
Just blasting. It's 1 o'clock in the morning, and they're just blaring noise.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
That, neighbors.
So, but it was really cool. We'd originally kind of thought, like, oh, man, we're stuck here for a day. It would have been great to have been able to go home a day earlier. But what it ended up being was just one of the coolest moments of the trip, getting to spend it with those kids. And then after 1 o'clock in the morning, they literally spent until like 2 or 3 in the morning making letters for each one of us. And each of us got a stack of letters to bring home with us. And one of the most important things to them, the kids at the house, was that we stayed at the house with them. We ate meals with them. We celebrated with them. We weren't just Americans that came and stayed at a hotel. We slept in triple bunk beds and ate their meals with them and celebrated their lives with them and really became Ugandans with them. And I think that was a really powerful thing for the kids and for us. And Doc has some examples of the things that they made us, which was so cool. They did it till like the middle of the night and then literally were up before us the next morning, like making breakfast and getting our clothes dried and helping us get ready to go home. Really, really cool. Now, at the tail end of the trip, one of the things that we got to do was just spend the day with Robert and Millie and help them celebrate their anniversary. So the last full day there, we went in to the city, and Robert got Millie some flowers, which you could see there. And then we went down to Lake Victoria near Entebbe Airport. We went to the beach and let them take photos. And just spent some time with them. We took them to a really good meal, which was delicious. It was really great. We went to a nice meal. Mm-hmm. We went shopping with them a little bit. I got a chance to spend some time with them. We let them know that our church family are bored while I was there. I emailed them and approved the ability to send $1,000 to them after we got back. They are going to be using that money to be able to buy a working freezer, I believe, for their home, because they have no way to freeze any food because their refrigerator doesn't work and they have no freezer in the house. So we were able to bless them and their family while we were there, sort of at the tail end of the trip. These last couple of pictures were just there. Now, on the way home, we did get trapped in Munich, Germany for a day. And so our trip did extend an extra day, which is why worship this last week looked a little different than what it was originally intended to be. But just got to spend a really great time with them on the last day, giving them a break from sort of like everything that they had going on in life the whole time, and just got to spend some time with them, which was really, really cool and super, super powerful. I want to close some of these. We'll talk through and talk through. I don't want to just leave randomly Robert in a Hawaiian shirt here in the background. Let's go find like a picture of the kids, okay? Some of you have a question about what happened with Lynette. What ended up happening with Lynette was we had to get her father, track him down and figure out where he was and get him to sign off on moving Lynette to the school. After we left, Millie tracked down her father, talked to him, had to go out of her way to go find him, to get him to sign over rights. We filed a report with the police and let them know about the child abuse that was going on. And then when Millie got to Kigali, the stepmom had bribed the local police in Kigali to deny the paperwork and not take Lynette out of the home so that they could keep her, she could keep her inside the home. We actually had to out-bribe the police in order to get them to come out with the appropriate paperwork. And on Sunday afternoon, I got the first pictures of Lynette with her haircut and her new mattress and her new trunk. And all of the supplies that she's going to need. So Lynette, my Ugandan daughter, will now be living full time at the school and celebrating her holidays with Robert and Millie in Kampala, and she will be safe from abuse. And so something that we're really celebrating and excited for. Yeah. My Saturday was a really bad day. Cause I woke up and found out that, yeah, there she is. There's a picture of her. Getting her mattress and everything, and I'll be able to send letters to her along with some money and all of that stuff to be able to just let her know that she has people in her life that love her and care about her and are there to support her. It'll give us the chance to continue to go back and visit her when I get a chance to go back to Uganda, which we'll talk about in a moment, and continuing to allow my family to do our best to treat her as a daughter. Right now, to adopt a child in Uganda, you have to live in Uganda for 3 years. So it's not a possibility for us to adopt a child from Uganda, at least not right now with the current policy. But it is in our capability to pay for her schooling, to pay for her food and her clothing, and to take care of her, to make sure that she's safe and make sure that she can continue to get an education, and then theoretically to visit her once a year, once every other year, just let her know that there are American and there's a family out here that loves her and that counts her as a member of their family. Someone asked how old are Robert and Millie. I think Millie is in her late 30s and Robert, I believe, is 42. Yeah, Millie is in, I think, maybe 38 or 39 years old. So, you know, it was a rough transition home initially, but it's just been a really powerful experience. So here's what I want to do. We have still 45 people in stream, which is amazing, especially if you're here for the first time tonight. Thank you for sticking with us, everybody, and being part of this. I would love each of us to share, now that we've had about 5 days home, what we think the most impactful part of the journey was. Because the reality is, guys, when you come home from a trip like this, you don't come home happy. You come home angry. You come home depressed. You come home overwhelmed. There's a lot of things, feeling-wise, that you come back when you come back into a first-world country. It's really hard to hear anybody complain ever again about anything ever. It's really hard to process your emotions. So we've had about 5 days now to work through those emotions and to ask, you know, how will the things we actually experienced genuinely impact our life back home? Because this isn't just about helping Robert and Millie and Maish and loving on kids. It is about that. We were able to do a ton for the school. But beyond that, it's also about the fact that these type of trips permanently change your life as a follower of Jesus. Like, your life becomes altered. You can't go back to the same life. And that enables you to live in a very potentially different way that goes to benefit schools like Maisha and places like Kagata, Uganda, theoretically for the rest of your life. And so I'd love to hear from each of you, and I don't care who goes first, about what is the thing that you think you're taking home with you from this trip that's been the biggest point of impact?
Yeah, I can go first. You know, I think for, I just want to preface all this, you know, as we share things, and like, some of these things that we'll share, like, they almost don't sound real. So I pray that you just, like, take our word for it. But for me, there was a moment whenever we were at the conference, whenever I went up and asked for prayer, and I ended up on my knees, and people were just praying over me, and everything else just kind of faded, and just over and over and over in my head, all that I could hear was, nothing else matters but Jesus. Like, nothing else matters but Jesus. Nothing else matters but Jesus. Like, that's what I took away, is that, like, if you look at the life of Robert and Millie and the life of, like, everyone that we met from the church and the students who know Jesus, like, what you see is that because they have Jesus, like, yeah, the problems in their life are still there. Like, there are still things that they struggle with. Like, Robert and Millie are paying to feed and educate, like, however many kids. Like, it doesn't mean that those, like, difficulties aren't there, but, like, they don't matter because they serve a God that's bigger than all that. And it's like, all the things in life that seem like they are difficult and, like, unsurmountable, it's like, none of them matter because the only thing that matters is Jesus. Like, and that is something that I've heard people say before, is like, Jesus is the only thing that matters. But, like, until you come face to face with your Lord and Savior and you realize that that's, like, the truth, like, it doesn't sink in until you allow it to sink in. So that was probably the biggest takeaway. That, and, like, joy is a choice. Like, you can choose to have joy. Like, there's no reason why a lot of these orphans who don't know their parents, who are living without a family, like, there's no reason why they should be as joyful as they are, but they choose to have the joy. And that was also really humbling, because it's like, I find all these things to complain about, and then, like, I can instead choose to be joyful. I can choose to lean into the joy that God has put in my life because of how good he is. So those are my two big takeaways.
I think for me, I'm still processing certain areas of the trip, for sure. But I guess for me, like, coming home to all this, and even sitting about here thinking about it now, like, sacrifice was something that's kind of played in my head some. And I, also, too, when we were in this world that felt so foreign, it was something that, like, I had heard someone say there. We heard about it multiple times, is this is 80% of the world. Those children that I was seeing hungry, those homes that were nothing more than some walls built out of mud and sticks or out of basic bricks that they had made themselves, that is the majority of the world. And I'm still trying to process and wrap my mind around that. And in the process of thinking through that and thinking through sacrifices, the most significant thing for me that has been playing in my head was with sacrifice, was thinking of Robert and Millie. I learned something in their home when we woke up to eat breakfast. And the breakfast came around 11 o'clock. I was like, oh, because we're kind of eating lunch. Like, did I miss breakfast? I'm like, oh, no, like, this is our breakfast, and then we'll eat dinner around 7. We don't have lunch. And they said the reason they didn't have lunch for all the kids in their home, minus the little ones who they gave a little bit of food in the middle of the day, was they could not afford to feed all those kids 3 meals. So they chose to cut down, including their own meals, to 2. so that they could have more children in their home. They had lived further in the capital in a home, and they chose to move outside the capital to travel further to work because that house that they were going to rent out there was bigger and they could fit more children. At any point in my life that I thought that I was going to run into a situation that I was going to have trouble putting food on the table, I would immediately be like, oh, okay, pump the brakes. There's no more giving in my house. There's no more charity work. There's no more sacrifices to be made. I got to keep food on the table. And they immediately saw that opportunity and went, nope, we can change how we do things more. We can give up more so that way we can have more children with a roof over their head. And that is something for me. I'm just like, that doesn't exist in my world, right? I've never met a person who does that. I've met people who can really reach out a hand and do amazing things, but they will not put a, you know, won't take the comforts of their own life at that risk, right? And these Robert and Millie were people who are doing something beyond what I could even think of doing to take care of more children. And that is something that I'm trying to process and bring home.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the biggest things that came back for me was a lot of their worship services, right? Like these people are suffering. They're not despite the outward appearance and how they interact with the world, you wouldn't know it, right? If we lived in the conditions that they lived in, I guarantee we, from our perspective and how we grew up, I understand that we live a different life, right? But, I don't know if I would have that amount of joy and that amount of dedication and worship that these people do when they have nothing. These people are, mostly these people are living on less than $1 a day. And yet, you come to any church service, and when they have an offering, there's almost not a single person who doesn't come and give something. Now, that person might be literally giving, one of these, which is 100 shillings, just for, three pennies. Or a bag of mangoes that they picked that morning because it's what they have. But they give out of the excess of their joy, not out of their actual things. And that's a wild thing for me. And to me, it's also the joy and generosity of the kids. This coin here that was in my backpack was given to me by a little kid. He walked up to a bunch of us and all put 100 shillings in our hands. Because he was just trying to give what he could to us. Now this is worthless. this is worth barely 3 pennies in our money. Couldn't buy a thing with it, right? But this isn't leaving my desk probably for the next decade. Because this was given out of the excess of joy, not the excess of things. And that it's just a wild, wild feeling from that. If even a few percent of the people in the U.S. Had that spirit of joy and had that spirit of giving from a place of joy and trying to spread just what little they could to help others, we wouldn't have hardly any issues. I firmly believe that. Mm-hmm. It's wild the amount of joy that these people have when they have literally nothing. It's crazy. And like Mark said, you're angry at the world, and it's hard to be back in society when people are upset that they want to buy 4 pairs of $300 shoes just because they look cool. And the urge when my buddy at work was talking about that to not smack his phone out of his hand was incredibly high. But I remember that all I can do and learn from them is what I take home in showing that joy and that peace that they had. That's the biggest thing I brought home with me from Uganda. So
I think for me, I was in Uganda once before, and this was Kyle's first time out of the country on an international mission. This was Greg has been to the Dominican, Doc has been a couple of places. For me as a returner to Uganda, I think one of the things that was the biggest impact for me was how much Uganda felt like home to me. And just this really, really weird way. The connection that I have with the people and the connection that I have with the red dirt and the smells and it feels like I should be there. Mm. Right. You know, I'm very thankful for everything that God has given me in my life. I'm very thankful for my children. I'm very thankful for my wife and my home and for Lux. There's probably a different life that Mark leads where he moves and gives his entire life to that country. And so I think for me, there was also this bit where as the lead pastor of Lux, I was looking more than just what I could do, but I was looking at what we could do. You know, at the very beginning of the stream, we had the passage up from the book of James, chapter 1. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. And just because we're an online church and just because we're a church that's made up of gamers doesn't mean that we don't have to do that. Right? Like, I think that when people look at our church, especially from the outside looking in, they think of us as sort of being an experiment. They think of us as sort of being like, oh, you're a gamer church, so you do gamer things. And yeah, we do. We partner with organizations like Love by Nerd, and we will continue to partner with nerd culture missionaries like Aki and Jate and Frost. But just, like, if we want to consider ourselves a church, like, we have to do this too. We have to also care for widows and orphans in their distress. And I'm not saying there aren't widows and orphans around me or around you, wherever it is that you're living. But I know for us at Lux that Uganda isn't going to be a place that we stop supporting and stop going to. And so what was the biggest impact for me? I think there were so many levels of impact in this trip in terms of the fact that, you know, we had this prayer team back home that was praying for us, which was just amazing. So shout out to the prayer team. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
I traveled with what was, and I've been to a couple of countries before. I traveled with what was the absolute best team bar none that I have ever traveled with. And I think it will be hard to ever beat this team. There was never a point where one of these guys complained. There was never a point when they wouldn't eat something, wouldn't go somewhere, wouldn't go in poop water, wouldn't eat an entire fish, wouldn't sweat, wouldn't pray.
I'll eat anything.
Wouldn't preach.
They had to try to stop me from eating things.
Yeah, actively, there was like a no street meat rule in our group because of how often.
And next time I go there, I'm breaking that. I'm getting me that sweet, yeah, sweet street meat.
How often Doc wouldn't eat street meat. There was nothing that the team wouldn't do. And so from a missions experience in terms of orphans, it beat any trip I've ever been on in terms of like unique experiences with the team. There's nothing that's going to beat riding on the roof of the van towards the savannah in Uganda. Like that experience is like one of the pinnacles of my life, right? There's few that are going to beat the spiritual experience of watching a woman, you know, get her child taken off her back and then freed from an evil spirit. There's
Rolex.
There's few things that are going to beat Peter, who took care of us at our hotel, or there's awesome. Few things that will beat the experience of watching firsthand poverty take the life of little children, right? And we wouldn't watch a child pass away in front of us, but we watch children that were dying from starvation right in front of our eyes. For us, right, the starving children aren't some fictitious thing that are distant anymore, right? They're not this thing that could happen or this thing that maybe happens somewhere and they put on videos and put in pictures to try to get you to emotionally react. For us, these children have names and they have faces. And knowing what is wild is that it was the orphans that were the happiest,
yeah,
right?
Yes.
I think being in Kigali and seeing the despondent stares of so many children that don't have parents, that don't have food, that don't have homes, that were in the school. But then seeing these children that you would think would have been the saddest of the children, the orphan children, and to know that because of the ministry of Robert and Millie, because they decided to support kids, for the record, they're both native Ugandans. Kigali is the town that Robert grew up in. So Robert grew up impoverished in that town, and somebody put the money up for him to go to school, which allowed him to get a scholarship to go to secondary school and university, which has allowed him to be an accountant. Millie had a similar story where she was abandoned as a child, lived with an aunt, abused as a child, and somebody saw something in her that invested money in her that enabled her to go to school, get a scholarship, to go to university, become a lawyer, and now she fights for the rights of children and women in Uganda. You know, the impact of realizing that cannibalism was a thing in this community 30 years ago, that most of the people worship a man who's dead and entombed on cult property next to the school, the spiritual darkness, everything across the board was so incredibly powerful that it made me come home and realize that this wasn't just a story for us. Like, this had to have been something, this has to be something that our church family gets behind. Which leads us to what's next. Because this isn't a one-time trip. So what's next is we're beginning to work on planning next year's trip to Uganda, which means there may be an opportunity for some of you to come with us. I personally need you to know that we won't take everybody. This is not a trip for the faint of heart. You don't land with a rescue line back home. You're 5 hours out of Kampala. You're 40 hours away from a good hospital. You need to be physically fit, mentally fit, and spiritually fit to go on this trip. We won't ever take a huge team, because the bigger the team, the more unmanageable it becomes. But we are going to open it up next year for some new people to come with us. And one of the things we're going to do is invite pastors from other larger churches to come along so they can see the heart of Robert and Millie and partner with them as well. Something else that's going to be coming is there's going to become a section of our website that's dedicated to Uganda. And on our website, you'll be able to pick a child by name and face to begin to support every month to ensure that they have food in their bellies, clothes on their back, and an education that they can get. It'll probably be $40 to $50 a month for you to support a child, and you'll become that child's sponsor. Robert and Millie don't have connections to things like Compassion or any other organization that's allowing them to bring money in. They have about $1,000 from sponsorships already that comes in every month, and everything else they sacrifice and give or go into debt for to feed the children. On top of that, tonight you have a chance to be able to start right now by partnering with Maisha's school, by giving tonight. Every cent that you give, whether it's a dollar, which is 3,600 Ugandan shillings, or thousands of dollars, you can give on our website right now. And every cent of it will be going to Robert and Millie and Maisha's school to support children like Lynette and like Vicky and like Siobhan and like, what was the little girl's name?
Sandra.
Every cent of it will go to support them. Right now they have 74 orphans that live at their school. 74. Most of those orphans share a bed. It's Robert and Millie's dream that they'll be able to build a dormitory so that every child that lives at the school will have their own bed. I really cannot put into context how insane that is. That the biggest thing on their mind is that they have 30-some beds with 70-some kids in them. And the thing they want more than anything else for their children is to put a roof on a dormitory so that they can put the orphans in it, so that every child would have their own bed. It takes $10,000 to finish that dormitory, to put a roof on it and to get it ready, equipped with beds and mattresses, to be able to sleep more kids so that every child can have their own bed. I am a really firm believer that there is $10,000 in our church, in the 40 people that are watching stream right now. But even if there isn't, I'm going to ask you, if you've never given a dime to Lux, don't give a dime to Lux. Give a dime to Maisha. Yes. Give to the school.
Yes.
This is not just an advertisement so that you'll give your money away. I'm just going to be perfectly honest with you. Like, I'm done having the conversation about I don't have enough. Because I've seen the faces of real poverty. And so I'm asking you tonight to prayerfully consider sacrificially giving in a way that you haven't given before, so that we're able to give beds to children who don't have a bed. And to be able to put food on the plates of kids who don't have food. and to be able to give a family to children who don't have a family. There's going to be more opportunities moving forward to partner with Myesha in the months and the years to come. There will be continual opportunities to go on trips to Uganda. So if you want to come and have the firsthand experience that many of these guys, that all of us had, that you'll be able to come with us in the future to go to Uganda and have that experience, to be able to sit with these kids, to be able to love on them and care for them. There'll be future opportunities to, I see two new donors who just came through. Thank you guys. I appreciate you. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for giving what you can. Thank you for bringing forward what you have. I appreciate you guys. Thank you. So if you're interested in going with us to Uganda, if you're interested in, maybe I'm clicking the wrong thing, where? Just luxdigitalchurch.com/give. If you're interested in continuing to support a child, the child sponsorship program will be live in the next couple of weeks here at our church. If you're interested in helping with future opportunities, there will be opportunities every year for one-off gifts to do things like purchasing food for the school or meat for holidays. Most of these kids only get meat a couple times a year, and it's only on holidays. So there'll be lots of opportunities in the future for you to continue to partner with Myesha through Lux Digital Church, and we would love to have you do that. Before we close tonight, anybody else have anything they want to offer, anything else they want to say?
I see that the Davis story, unfortunately, there was only one or two pictures of him in the pictures that we showed. But Davis is a boy who has this big, beautiful smile. When he smiles, his entire face lights up, so he was really easy to see. And actually, one of the early videos of us playing netball, you'll see me lift him up so he can throw one in. And he is about the size of my daughter, who is 2, 2.5. He might be closer to a 3-year-old size. But I asked about him. I was like, oh, you know, what's Davis's story? Davis is 7. He has been so malnourished that he has not grown. He is, again, about the size of a 2.5 to a 3-year-old, and they only got him roughly 6 months ago into Myesha. And he, at that time, at 6 years old, he was almost 7, he still could not use the bathroom properly, among other things. So they now have him in a safe place where he gets 3 meals a day, and he has a roof over his head, and he might get an education, and he's working on one now. He was a boy that, as soon as I got there, stuck out to me. And the girls that I have a chance of being able to support, of Valerie and her sister Victoria, were abused by their father, and you can see some of their scars, and that's how they got absorbed into the school. And Valerie is incredible. She spends so much of her time at 13 years old taking care of the little ones. One thing that was really significant for me too is the school is they have 3 meals a day, and that it feeds the entire school, but it is the same thing day in, day out. It is beans, it is boiled maize. Occasionally they have porridge, and they have an avocado tree that they get to give them. But I was talking to Robert, and he said that they only have enough money right now at the school that every other Sunday they get to buy some fruits at market and let the kids have fruits. So just realize how far stretched their money is. And how that sounds like $40 a month doesn't do much, but 3 people do that, and sometimes that school will be able to buy more shoes, will be able to buy more food for these kids. Most of the kids asked us what our favorite food was, and they wanted to know what meat we ate, because they have only had pork once or twice before, and they thought it was so good when they had it. When we complain about what am I going to eat tonight for dinner, because I want to make sure I have something I enjoy.
Yeah, and like to piggyback off of Kyle and really just like show you the positive side of what your giving can do. It's like the U.S. dollar literally multiplies whenever you give, and it's used in Uganda. Like the amount that the U.S. dollar can purchase whenever it's converted into shillings is wild. Like you give $70 U.S. dollars. Can literally buy like eggs for the entire school, protein for all of the orphans who live there. Like it's wild to see how much money can be stretched whenever whenever the exchange rate hits. So like, if you're worried if like your little amount of giving will do anything, yes, it literally will. Like, yes. $15 can stretch and be used a lot. $40 a month, $50 a month, like one-time gifts, like it really legitimately is making a difference.
Huge difference.
Like, to put a little bit of perspective, like, I don't know if you guys will see that. Remember that bag of avocados they had in the back of the car?
Yeah. It was enormous.
They were, like, bringing to market to sell. It was, like, the size of, like, me, yeah. Right? That entire thing of avocados was about the equivalent of 10 U.S. bucks. That's it.
Yeah.
We pay that for two of those here. So, like Greg said, like, those little bits can buy enough food for an entire school. Like, it's crazy. So it goes a long ways.
Yeah, I just want to thank the next three people who decided to step up and give, and we're not going to extend this much longer, but I'll say this. There's 40 of us in stream and there's 5 of us who have given tonight. So if you think I'm not talking to you, I am talking to you. I'm asking you, I would feel weird asking you. I never ask this directly when it comes to the giving at Lux, because I don't feel as comfortable with it. But when it comes to this, I feel super comfortable with it. And if you're a member of our church family and you call this church your home, then I'll just be frank. Like, I'll be honest with you. I want you to give to this. I want you to sacrifice for this. I'm telling you, it's worth it. I'm telling you that you'll change lives radically as a product of it. And you know, I think part of coming home angry is a little bit of the boldness in that request. So if you haven't decided to pull the trigger and to give tonight, I'm asking you right now, go get online right now and give. It makes a difference. It changes lives. And if our stories are not convincing enough to you, then, you know, some of the pictures of these children who are real people with real names, real faces, real stories, real hurts, real burdens.
Real souls.
Real souls. I'm praying that that will change your mind. As we get ready to close tonight, I want to thank you guys for coming out to Monday Night Live. It's been, 2.5 hours maybe. I appreciate every single person who's given tonight. Thank you for sacrificing. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for standing with us and standing with Maisha. There's going to be lots of opportunities in the future. In honor of your anger, thank you, Mary. There's going to be lots of opportunities to continue to participate and give to the church in the future, and to give to the church, meaning Cornerstone Church, and to Maisha Holistic Foundation. Right now, I'm still pretty jet-lagged, so I'll be honest with you guys. I'm tired, and at one point or another, this box battery went bad, and every noise that's coming through my ears sounds like it's in the bottom of a drum that's at the bottom of the ocean, which is freaking the worst. So it literally just quit working altogether, so I'm just going to unplug it. Thank you, guys. I'm seeing a few more donations come through. I appreciate you guys. Listen, we have church on Wednesday night, 8:30 p.m. EST, twitch.tv/LuxDigitalChurch. I want to give a special thank you to Doc, to Kyle, and to Greg, who are willing to be part of this Monday Night Live. This one was a truly unique Monday Night Live, unlike any other. Thank you. Another person, 4 of you tonight have never given at Lux before, and you gave to Maisha and to Uganda tonight. Thank you for taking that step in faith, and thank you for giving. I appreciate you so much. There's a 4th new donor. Thank you so much for taking it. Or a 4th new donor, 5th new donor. Thank you guys so much for taking that step of faith. We'll keep that open for the rest of the night. So if you haven't given yet, you can give tonight. And any cent that comes in tonight doesn't go to us. Everything will go directly to Maisha. Struggling to make a donation online, we'll give it to you this weekend. That's perfectly fine, Brenda. That's totally okay as well. As we close tonight, reminder, Wednesday night is church. It is the end of our series on prayer called Our Father. I'm going to be closing out the series this week, and also telling you about the series coming up, which is called Screen Names, and what's going to be coming up in the fall. We're going to be hanging out this week, so I hope you'll come out and join us. And I think this is the last week of the month. Also, thank you. Another donation coming in. Appreciate you guys so much for standing with Maisha. Online is rough. Text to give is easier. Bougie's the only person who used text to give, and he used it twice, and then I got rid of it. thank you for the next donation. Appreciate you guys. Yeah, it's the last one, so we're giving away a video game as well, which you might just be able to get your hands on something like Baldur's Gate 3 if you win, or Starfield that comes out at the end of August. So come and join us this week for church. We're going to be giving away a video game, closing out a series, and talking about the future. Hopefully I'll have a little bit more of a voice by the time that happens. We appreciate you guys for being here. Thank you for making Lux what it is. Thank you for supporting our mission team. Thank you for partnering with the orphans of Kigali, Uganda. Man, I pray it's one of these things that in years from now, our church will be able to look and see the dormitories that we've built, yes, and the, yes, school buildings that we've built, and the children's lives that have been changed, and the way in which the children of Maisha were able to get an education, which was able to lead them into a university, that was able to lead them to begin overturning the corruption of the Ugandan government that keeps the people oppressed and poor. It'll be your donations, your sacrifice, your visits to Uganda that will enable a generation of children to raise up and change what the next generation will see. It really does make that type of a difference. I love you guys so much. And to close out, here's a picture of Kyle with a random man. Who really wanted a picture of Kyle, but had no way to receive the picture himself. And on that amazing note, we love you guys so much. That link for giving for Uganda will be active for the rest of the night. Thank you for making it to Monday Night Live. We'll see you guys on Wednesday night.